So this brings up the issue of what neural nets are more or less appropriate for. What is the restriction bias and the inductive bias of this class of classifiers and regression algorithms? So Charles, can you remind us what restriction bias is?
Well, restriction bias tells you something about the representational power of whatever data structure it is that you're using. So in this case, the network of neurons. And it tells you the set of hypotheses that you're willing to consider.
Right. So if there's a great deal of restriction, then there's lots and lots of different kinds of models that we're just not even considering. We're restricting our view to just a subset of those. So in the case of neural nets, what restrictions are we putting?
Well, and we started out with a simple perceptron unit, and that we decided was linear. So we were only considering planes. Then we moved to networks so that we could do things like XOR, and that allowed us to do more. And then we started sticking sigmoids and other arbitrary functions into nodes so that we could represent more and more. And you mentioned that if we let the weights get big and we have lots of layers and lots of nodes, we can be really, really complex. So it seems to me that we're actually not doing much of a restriction at all. So let me ask you this then, Michael. What kind of functions can we represent? Clearly, we can represent Boolean functions because we did that. Can we represent continuous functions?
That's a great question to ask. We should try to figure that out. So in the case, as you said, in Boolean functions, we can, if we give ourselves a complex enough network with enough units, we can basically map all the different subcomponents of any Boolean expression to threshold-like units and basically build a circuit that can compute whatever Boolean function we want. So that one definitely can happen. So what about continuous functions? So what is a continuous function? A continuous function is one where as the input changes, the output changes somewhat smoothly, right? There's no jumps in the function like that.
Well, there's no discontinuities, that's for sure.
All right, now if we've got a continuous function that we're trying to model with a neural network, as long as it's connected, it has no discontinuous jumps in any place in the space, we can do this with just a single hidden layer as long as we have enough hidden units, as long as there's enough units in that layer. And essentially one way to think about that is if we have enough hidden units, each hidden unit can worry about one little patch of the function that it needs to model. And the patches get set at the hidden layer, and at the output layer they get stitched together. And if you just have that one layer, you can make any function as long as it's continuous. If it's arbitrary, we can still represent that with a neural network. Any mapping from inputs to outputs we can represent, even if it's discontinuous, by just adding one more hidden layer, so two total hidden layers. And that gives us the ability to not just stitch together these patches at their seams, but also to have big jumps between the patches. So, in fact, neural networks are not very restrictive in terms of their bias as long as you have a sufficiently complex network structure, right? So maybe multiple hidden layers and multiple units.
So that worries me a little bit, Michael, because it means that we're almost certainly going to overfit, right? If we can have arbitrarily complicated neural networks, then we can represent anything we want to, including all of the noise that's represented in our training set. So how are we going to avoid doing that?
Excellent question. So it seems like there isn't exactly that worry. But it is the case, though, that when we train neural networks, we typically give them some bounded number of hidden units, and we give them some bounded number of layers. And so it's not like any fixed network can actually capture any arbitrary function. So any fixed network can only capture whatever it can capture, which is a smaller set. So going to neural nets in general doesn't have much restriction, but any given network architecture actually does have a bit more restriction. So that's one thing. The other is, hey, well, we can do with overfitting what we've done the other times when to deal with overfitting, and that's to use ideas like cross-validation. And we can use cross-validation to decide how many hidden layers to use. We can use it to decide how many nodes to put in each layer, and we can also use it to decide when to stop training because the weights have gotten too large. So, and this is, it's probably worth pointing this out, that this is kind of a different property from the other classes of supervised learning algorithms we've looked at so far. So in a decision tree, you build up the decision tree, and you may have overfit, but it is what it is. in regression, you know, you solve the regression problem, and again, that may have overfit. What's interesting about neural network training is it's this iterative process that you started out running, and as it's running, it's actually error is going down and down and down. So in this standard kind of graph, we get the error on the training set dropping as we increase iterations. It's doing a better and better job of modeling the training data. But in classic style, if you look at the error in the in some kind of held out test set or maybe in a cross validation set, you see the error starting out kind of high and maybe dropping along with this. And then at some point, it actually turns around and goes the other way. So here, even though we're not changing the network structure itself, we're just continuing to improve our fit, we actually get this pattern that we've seen before, that the cross validation error can turn around, and at this, you know, at this low point, you may want to just stop training your network there. The more you train it, possibly the worse you'll do. And again, it's reflecting this idea that the complexity of the network is not just in the nodes and the layers, but also in the magnitude of the weights. Typically what happens at this turnaround point is some weights are actually getting larger and larger and larger. So I just wanted to highlight that difference between neural net function approximation and what we see with some of the other algorithms.